Well, good morning and welcome to Community Bible Church. It is certainly a blessing to see you. If you're still out in the hallway, please come on in and find a place to be seated. We are very, very glad to have you here. What I would like for us to do this morning is to just briefly have a moment of reflection and preparation of our hearts for worship. So in a moment, we're going to just kind of bow our heads and close our eyes for a moment to pray together, to pray individually and silently, asking the Lord to minister to us today, and then we'll begin our time together. So if you would, please just bow with me for a brief time of reflection and prayer, and then we will seek the Lord together. Dear Heavenly Father, we pray that you would quiet our hearts before you and that we would receive from you your word, your grace, your power, your work in our lives, and that we would be responsive, Lord, to your work in us today. We ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. If you would please stand with me, we are going to read together from Psalm 19. We'll read basically the first four verses. We'll read these aloud, and then we'll join in singing together. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above declares his handiwork. Day to day pours out speech, and night to night reveals knowledge. There is no speech, nor are there words whose voice is not heard. Their measuring line goes out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. Let's join with nature in singing together, "This is My Father's World."
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings.
Once again, it is a blessing to see each of you here this morning. If you are a guest with us here today, we would love to get to know you a little bit better. One way to do that is to take the card that's in front of you and fill that out, put it in the offering plate when it passes by here in a few moments. I'm going to give a couple of announcements and reminders that we need to hear together, and then we're going to have a quick ministry highlight from Jasper County Recovery Home. So let me just begin by saying that this morning, or after this morning's service, is care groups. There's a care group at the Foreman's house. There's also our care group got so large that we had to move to a bigger house. So our care group, I've kept saying that it's going to be at our house the last few weeks, but it's now going to be at the Sharps' house. The address for that is in the bulletin as well. Also, there are a couple of Operation Christmas Child work days this week, if you would like to be a part of helping with that. Our Awana is focused on Operation Christmas Child as well, so the kids are going to be packing boxes this Wednesday night for Awana in addition. And then I just want to mention that we have a youth retreat this Friday and Saturday. We kind of refer to it as our in-house youth retreat. And I just want to encourage you to be praying for that. We have another church joining with us this year, and a number of our young people have invited their friends to come. Just pray that that will be a blessing. Maybe a couple of other things that should be mentioned. Young at Heart is coming up, one of their meetings. There's a sign-up and details on the literature table. And then also in addition to that, we need some extra help for Wednesday, April the 22nd, for our final Awana night. A number of you have helped with this before. It's a really fun night to see all those kids because they get to sort of spend their, what we call, Awana bucks at a fun fair at the end of the year. They've been working and memorizing scripture. So if you would like to volunteer to help for that or to make a donation for some sweets, for some goodies for that, please speak to either Wendy Cesar or Jennifer Fitzhenry. They would be able to help direct you and how you can help with that. And we do need extra volunteers for that night. Well, in just a little bit, we're going to receive our offering. And we do kind of remind ourselves week by week that a little part of all of our offerings goes to some form of ministry or missions. And we try to highlight a missionary or a mission organization. And today we're going to highlight Jasper County Recovery Home. So Al is just going to come and share briefly. And then when he is done sharing kind of a recap of their ministry right here in Jasper County, I'll come back and lead in prayer for your organization.
Well, hello, everybody. My name is Al Ferrer, and I am the director at the Jasper County Recovery House. We are a faith-based rehabilitation program that's geared for men 18 and over. We have been in Rensselaer for 5 years now, and in those 5 years, I mean, we have grown and a lot of things have happened. We've realized that a lot of the men come to us, and the way the program works is they come to us for 30 to 45 days, which is called the crisis phase, and then they transfer to Elkhart where they finish off the year program. What we've noticed in this last bit of time in the last 5 years is that the men that come to us for the crisis phase, they succeed, they actually stay, they stick it through. And the reason that is our house, it's a small little farmhouse. We have 8 beds. We only do 5 the most because it's a pretty small house and we don't want to get too crammed in. So it's personal. We eat together. We do everything together. We're always around each other. So if somebody's going through something, we're there to help them. We're there to lift them up. When we're going through stuff, they help us go through stuff. And we've noticed that in the last 5 years by doing this, most of the men that come through our house finish the program and actually succeed and finish the program. Last year's banquet, we had 13 or 14, and I think 7 of those guys actually came through the Jasper House. So it's actually working. Our program works because we gear people back to Jesus. How many people know Jesus is the answer? Right? Yeah. So a lot of, you know, secular programs, they try to talk about what the problem is. We don't talk about the problem. We talk about the solution. The solution is Jesus. So we point them right back to Jesus. We're in the Bible a lot. They say that going through our program is kind of like 7 years worth of Bible study in 1 year. I mean, it's pretty intense. We're always reading the Bible, memory verses, going to churches, going to Bible studies, and we've realized that that's the way to do it. We want to thank you guys for everything you guys do for us. We also have a fundraiser coming up on the 29th. It's going to be in Rensselaer. It's Nelson's Chicken. Anybody ever have Nelson's Chicken before? Yeah? Well, we're back, and it's going to sell out like it did last time. So if you guys want, we have flyers, and if you want, you could pre-buy tickets. But I just want to tell you guys thank you. Thank you for letting us come, and thank you for everything. Thank you, guys.
Well, thank you, Al, for what you're doing in ministering there. I just found out this morning a lot of these guys work for Jay Whitfitt and his crew at Belstra's. So thank you for that connection and your investment in them as well. I'm pretty sure that our church has been supporting your organization, not the broader Teen and Adult Challenge, but the Jasper County Recovery Home since the very beginning, I'm pretty sure. So you're on our heart, and we do pray for you, and we love you, and let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for the different people that you laid this on their heart a few years ago to get this house and to get started in ministering to men in our community and through our community and providing them with Bible training and jobs and Lord, working through some recovery issues. Lord, we are grateful for that. And so, Lord, today I want to pray for each one of the men that have joined us here for worship today and their part of the journey. Lord, I pray that you administer to them and keep them strong. Lord, thank you for Al and his ministry right here in our county and his ministry to men. And I pray, oh God, that you would bless him, that you would use him, and that, Lord, you would meet all of his needs and all the needs of the organization at the Jasper County Recovery House. Lord, use what a little bit that we give, use that for your glory, we pray, in the lives of these men, and meet all of their needs, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much. Well, now we are going to receive our offering. This is part of the way that we worship the Lord, is to give back to him some small part of what he has provided to us. So men, if you guys would come, and I've already prayed, so we'll just go ahead and pass those plates and receive the offering that we are planning to give today.
Would you stand and join us as we continue singing?
Man of sorrows, what a name for the Son of God who came, ruined sinners to reclaim. Alleluia, what a Savior. What a Savior.
Today's scripture reading is from Romans chapter 1, verses 16 and 17. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith for faith, and it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. Let's pray together. Dear God in heaven, we thank you so much for the time that we can spend together here at Community Bible Church during a service where we worship you, we pray to you, we submit our offerings. Lord, we hear the preaching of the word. We sing to you, Lord, and we pray that those things would be received by you and you would be honored and glorified by what we do here this morning. Lord, we're so thankful for the message of the gospel. Lord, we're so thankful for salvation, that you have saved us from sin and death and despair, and have given us a new life. And God, we just pray this morning as we're here together that as the preaching of your word goes out, that it would go out with power, that those seeds in our hearts that would be planted, that you would water and germinate, and they would grow, and it would be that we would grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ, and that we would give you glory and give it back to you. Thank you so much, Lord. Pray for Pastor Rodney as he's preparing to speak to us this morning. I pray that as the word is preached, again, Holy Spirit, that you would just move in us, teach us from your word, and give us wisdom, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Tom, for leading us in prayer, and then to our worship team for leading us in worship. Boys and girls, fourth grade and down, you can be dismissed to go to your class at this time. Thank you for being with us so far, and be good for Miss Shannon. Now, before I share a little anecdote and kind of introduce the sermon, I feel a little bit as if I should say kind of a caveat. Please don't judge me for what I'm about to say. So, one of my secret vices, one of my guilty pleasures, is following a particular YouTube channel called Venture Forward that is about this guy for who about 4 years, he's not doing it right now, but for about 4 or 5 years, he lived and traveled in his four-door Jeep Wrangler, right? And he traveled all over the country, including Canada and Alaska and some other places. He lived there. He lived in this thing. And so don't judge me for wasting time watching this 20-minute thing every week, okay? But nevertheless. And so my illustration comes from one of his experiences. One day he was teaching somebody else how to four-wheel in a backcountry track, right? And he was in the mountains, and there was a lot of rock and stone and loose stone and all of these different things, and this is a lot of stuff I don't know anything about, right? So you have to choose your line, apparently, and you go up the hill and you go back down the hill, and you do things carefully. Well, in this one particular situation, this person that he was teaching how to do this, teaching them this skill, they were going down a hill. And apparently it was relatively easy in this particular situation. It looked very rough, and it was very rough, and it looked complicated, but apparently it wasn't especially technical. And he said, now you're going to go there, you're going to point in that direction, you're going to choose that line, I guess that's the terminology that you would use, and then you're going to push this button, which is in a Jeep Wrangler apparently, and in the newer ones they have something called descent control, right? And so it kind of does the braking for you, and then he said you're going to let go of the wheel, and you're going to allow gravity to turn the wheel according to the terrain until you get to the bottom of the hill. It wasn't a very long hill, and of course with the descent control they were going quite slowly, but it worked. I watched it. It really did work. Well, Romans chapter 9 has some rough terrain. Okay, and we've been through some of that terrain already. We might say that we climbed the hill. And for some of us this morning, what we need to do, maybe not so much the descent control, because I don't know what that analogy would be, but some of us need to put our crash helmet on, we need to strap in with our 5-point seatbelt, and we need to let go of the wheel. And we need to let the Bible, God's Word, drive or guide the wheels for us. So, you know, I invited you, Al, and your men to come, and then I remembered I'm preaching from Romans chapter 9 today. This is some rough terrain from the Bible, and this may prompt some interesting discussions around the table at Jasper County Recovering Home, and maybe around all of our tables as we look at this passage of Scripture together. It is always good to discuss it afterwards after you hear a passage, and I think especially today. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to kind of strap in, but we're going to let go of the wheel, and we're going to let the very verses of Scripture kind of drive the car for us today. Now, we've looked at Romans chapter 9 a couple of times already, a couple of weeks ago. And in verses 1 to 5, we just see an expression of Paul's grief over the lostness of humanity. I mean, it is almost literally gut-wrenching. He says in chapter 9, verse number 2, I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. And he's talking about the lostness of the nation of Israel by and large, but we could expand that to the lostness of humanity. So he is expressing his own grief there about the Jewish nation that has not believed. And then, starting in verse number 6, he begins to explain that there's always been a difference. There's always been a difference between, especially working from the Old Testament background, there's always been a difference between being a physical descendant of Abraham for the Israelite nation, and those who truly embraced their spiritual Israelite heritage and became a true child of God. And in the end, as we kind of work our way down through these paragraphs, in the end, Paul the Apostle rests his case about how some people come to faith and genuine childhood in the family of God, and how it seems that some do not, who should have. They had all kinds of spiritual privileges. He rests his case not so much in their national descent, or not in their own decision-making, or in their psychological predisposition, or in the circumstances of their life. But he rests his case for who comes to faith in the eternal decisions of God himself. And so we see that, and again, this is part of the rocky terrain. Romans chapter 9, verse number 15. He says, for he says to Moses, so God is speaking to Moses back in Exodus, I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. So then it, meaning salvation, really, or a relationship with God through the forgiveness of sins, so then it depends not on human will or exertion, but on God who has mercy. And then skip down to verse number 18. So then, he even makes it stronger. So then, he has mercy on whomever he wills, and he hardens whomever he wills. So Paul knows, and maybe I should say, as the preacher here this morning, I should say God knows. God knows that this will make all of us uncomfortable, this kind of strong emphasis on the decisions of God preempting our own. It will make all of us uncomfortable, and it may make some of us angry, right? So Paul acknowledges this. He has already acknowledged it to some degree. He says in verse number 14, what shall we say then? Is there injustice on God's part? And then he answers, by no means. So Paul the Apostle acknowledges this, and so should we. We should acknowledge this. I acknowledge that this can be quite uncomfortable. But what he says next in our text for today, starting in verse number 19, does not resolve the discomfort. If anything, it's going to make us more uncomfortable and more people angry, what Paul has to say under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So this is where we let go of the wheel, right? And this is where we just acknowledge this is uncomfortable for us, but nevertheless, we're going to let the Bible drive our understanding of what God is saying to us here this morning. We're going to follow the text of God's Word. We're going to remember that it is God's Word. And ultimately, we should humble ourselves before the truth of God and the truth of His Word. So, let's read, and I'm going to do this as we did a couple of weeks ago in the early parts of chapter 9. We're going to read a few verses, stop for some explanation and application, and then a few verses more bit by bit. So, Romans chapter 9, verses 19 and 20. You will say to me then, so remember, what has he just said? God has mercy on whomever he wills in verse number 18, and he hardens whomever he wills. Verse number 19, you will say to me then, why does he still find fault? For who can resist his will? Verse number 20, but who are you, O man, to answer back to God? Will what is molded say to its molder, why have you made me like this? So, there is an outline in the bulletin this morning, if that's something that will help you in following along. And I'm going to, for each point this morning, we're going to have sort of two ways of saying that point. And some of them are a little more catchy, but then the subtitle for each point is going to be kind of the heartbeat of what the text is saying for us here this morning. So, number one, who do you think you are anyway? Number one, who do you think you are anyway? The point that Paul is getting across in verses 19 and 20 is this: the grace of God is exalted by humbling human pride. The grace of God is exalted by humbling human pride. So it's important for us, Paul the Apostle, having brought up this tension of God has mercy on whomever he wills, and God hardens whomever he wills, which seems to go against our own mental human understanding of the way that life works, right? And our own sense of free will and our own sense of decision making. That seems to go against the grain of the way that we would normally think. And so what does Paul the Apostle do in responding to that tension? Well, it's important to say, first of all, what he does not say. He does not quickly resolve this tension, this supposed conflict between our own sense of freedom of will and decision making and God's eternal election before we were born or even before the worlds began. He does not resolve that by referring to human faith. Now, in the book of Romans, Paul the Apostle is not shy about talking about faith, right? Justification is by faith and faith alone. And so he's not shy about talking about that, but he doesn't bring that up here, and he doesn't do that for a reason. He does not want us to think that somehow we can explain God's eternal choices based on God's foreknowledge of some people will have faith and some people will not. That's just not the answer that he gives to this tension. In fact, just spoiler alert, he never resolves this tension. Okay, he just doesn't do it. And we'll talk a little bit about that again a couple of points down the line. He, in fact, instead of resolving this tension, he literally tightens the screws on us in verse number 19 when he says, you're going to respond back. Why does God find fault for who can resist his will? Essentially what he is saying, he's acknowledging that the logical question would be, how can God hold people accountable for decisions that he predetermined before the ages began? How can God hold us accountable for that? Verse number 19, why does God still find fault? For who can resist his will? And basically Paul's answer in verse number 20 is, who do you think you are anyway to ask God questions like that? He's not pulling back, he's pushing harder. And essentially, one of the things that we should notice is when he says in verse number 20, who are you, O man? He's putting us in our place, right? You're a human, God is God, to answer back to God. Now, verse number 19 was two questions, not statements. Two questions, no statement at all. But what Paul is saying here is that those questions are ultimately an answer. They are a statement back to God. In fact, in some sense, they are an accusation to God that this is somehow unfair. Paul is continuing to push back, and simply all that he says, he answers with a question at the end of verse number 20. Will what is molded say to its molder, why have you made me thus? He's just basically saying, you need to remember who you are. You need to remember that God is the creator and you are the creation, and that the creation ultimately does not have the right to question the will of the creator. Now, that doesn't mean that we can't ask questions. Okay, we can. And we can say, Lord, this bothers me. And you may say that for the rest of your life, right? Okay, but nevertheless, we do not have a right to use those questions to accuse God of something that is not true. Paul is putting us and our questions in our place. And it turns out that the Bible does this relatively frequently, right? Maybe more than we would normally think. And a lot of times what the Bible does is it simply reminds us of the vast difference, the great gulf between God in all of his sovereign greatness and us in our creatureliness, right? It just, the Bible does this again and again and again and again. So here's another place where you need to kind of strap in, because here we go. We're going to look at about five or six of these. What I want you to do is to turn in your Bibles to Job chapter 38. Turn to Job chapter 38. Now, I'm going to hit 1 or 2 before we get to Job, but you're going to kind of wait for me there in Job chapter 38, because this is one of the places where God, the Creator, speaks with such clarity. In a sense, he's putting Job in his place in the final chapters of the book of Job. But before we go there, we're going to take a quick look, and this one will be on the screen for you. Exodus chapter 3, verse number 5. Exodus 3, verse number 5. This is where Moses sees the burning bush. He decides, because the burning bush is not consumed, that he will go over and he will look at what is happening, this amazing thing, this great thing. And he realizes that God is speaking to him. Actually, in verse number 4, when the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, "Moses, Moses." Moses answers, "Here I am." And then God says, verse number 5, "Do not come near. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground." There is this sense almost as if where Moses almost doesn't belong there, right? He must make a physical gesture of respect to be able to be in the holy presence of God. Because God is holy, Moses is a sinner, and he does not deserve to be there. He does not belong in the great, sovereign, glorious presence of the Lord. It is again a reminder, God is holy, we are not. There is this great gulf between us and our sovereign, holy God. Now, we're going to do kind of a string of verses in the book of Job, starting in verse number 38, in Job chapter 38. And it just so happens that it's kind of every other chapter. It's chapter 38, chapter 40, chapter 42, and it's the first few verses of each chapter. As you know, Job, in his extreme suffering, has begun to kind of question God. He's begun to question whether God is treating him justly. Is God treating him fairly? He's begun to kind of have those questions. In fact, it's similar to the same vocabulary that we've run across in Romans chapter 9. Is this really fair for God, the Creator, to treat his creation this way? And so God begins to speak to Job, and he speaks to him repeatedly, and it becomes uncomfortable for Job eventually. But this is what God does. As the Creator, he speaks to Job. Verse number 1, starting in verse number 1 of Job chapter 38. "Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, 'Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Dress for action like a man. I will question you, and you make it known to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who determines its measurements? Surely you know, or who stretched out the line upon it?'" In other words, God is speaking to him, and he's saying, you know, where were you when I sovereignly created this world? How is it that you know enough to accuse me of injustice? You're the creation. You're a speck in the midst of all of the creation. How can you question me in this way? And by the way, a lot of us know from another Old Testament story. Do you remember how God was speaking to one of the prophets, and the prophet's hiding in a cave, and there was an earthquake, there was a fire, and there was a whirlwind? But God spoke in a still small voice. Do you remember that story with one of the prophets? What is God doing here? God is speaking out of the whirlwind, right? God can speak out of fire. He did that in the Bible too, by the way. He can speak in an earthquake if he wants to. He can speak in a still small voice. But when he wanted to put somebody in his place, he spoke out of the whirlwind. He didn't just hold back. He spoke clearly and loudly to Job out of this whirlwind. Now, there's something similar to this a couple of chapters over. Turn to Job chapter 40. And again, verse number 1. Job chapter 40. "And the Lord said to Job, 'Shall a fault finder contend with the Almighty? He who argues with God, let him answer it.' Then Job answered to the Lord and said, 'Behold, I am of small account. What shall I answer you? I lay my hand on my mouth. I have spoken once, and I will not answer twice, but I will proceed no further.' Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, 'Dress for action like a man, and I will answer you, and you make it known to me. Will you even put me in the wrong? Will you condemn me that you may be in the right?'" So Job has humbled himself. Job has said, "You're right, Lord," and God keeps going. He continues to speak out of the whirlwind and says, I'm not sure that you really have the point yet. And he says, dress for action. I will question you. Will you put me in the wrong? And the answer to that question is no human can put the Creator in the wrong ever, period, at all. No matter what we think or the discomfort that we may feel with God's sovereign choices. So God speaks to him again for another two chapters. I mean, for some of us, we start to think, poor Job. I mean, we were thinking poor Job when all of his trials came. But standing before God, having to answer for his accusations against God, poor Job. I mean, God just won't let him go. And then finally, chapter 42, the first six verses or so. Now this is Job. He has gotten the point completely. Job says in chapter 42, verse number 1, then Job answered the Lord and said, I know that you can do all things and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Who is this that hides counsel without knowledge? Therefore I have uttered what I did not understand, things too wonderful for me which I did not know. Hear and I will speak. I will question you and I will make it known to me. And you will make it known to me. He's kind of quoting himself and he's saying, I was a fool to say these things. I have heard of you by the hearing of the ear, but now my eye sees you. Therefore I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes. So he acknowledges, we cannot accuse God of anything, no matter how uncomfortable his sovereign greatness may make us feel. Now, just kind of moving on, we're going kind of from the beginning of the Bible now to the middle of the Bible, a little bit further on into the Bible in the book of Ecclesiastes. In Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verse number 2, it says this, be not rash with your words. Let not your heart be hasty to utter a word before God, for God is in heaven and you are on earth. Therefore, let your words be few. Something similar to this we find in the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 28 and 29. Therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, and thus let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and with awe, for our God is a consuming fire. There's just something about God that we will not always comprehend, and we do not have a right to question him or accuse him of anything. At least part of the purpose of these kinds of passages, including our text for this morning in Romans chapter 9, is simply to put us in our place, to humble us before the awesome sovereignty of God as Creator. And frankly, he has the right to do whatever he wants to do with his creation. Now, in case you haven't figured this out already, as we proceed through Romans chapter 9, and I want to encourage you to get back from, I think we were in Job last together, get back to Romans chapter 9. In case you were wondering, he continues this theme. And this is not warm fuzzy time yet. So let's take a look at verse number 21 through 23, Romans 9, 21 through 23. Has the potter no right over the clay to make out of the same lump one vessel for honorable use and another for dishonorable use? For what if God, desiring to show his wrath and to make known his power, has endured with much patience vessels of wrath prepared for destruction, in order to make known the riches of his glory for vessels of mercy, which he has prepared beforehand for glory? So, verse number two, or point number two, I should say, point number two, God has rights too. God has rights too. That's what Paul is doing in these verses. He is saying, and he sets the tone in verse number 21, has the potter no right over the clay, authority over the clay, a right to do with the clay what he wants? It's as if, we see children arguing over their toys, and sometimes the way to resolve the argument is say, well, whose toy is it? Then he or she can do what they want with that. The clay belongs to the potter. We belong to God. We are His. So the little sub-point or the explanation of number two, the grace of God is exalted by acknowledging His right to rule His creation. The grace of God is exalted by acknowledging His right to rule His creation. God has rights too. He's the potter. We're the clay. We don't have a right to question how He fashions His clay. And God has a right to fashion His clay the way He so desires. Now, there are a couple of things going on here. So, Paul the Apostle is using this question in verse number 21 to essentially assert God's rights. But he is using the language of creation, is he not? The potter has a right over the clay to make out of the same lump one vessel for honorable use and another for dishonorable. So we need to kind of pause for a second and make sure that we understand at least one thing here. And that is simply this. Because of this language of creation, we want to make sure that we don't think the wrong thing. We should not think that God has somehow made some people good and some people bad. Okay? No, God made creation good, right? Was that not the chorus of Genesis chapter 1? It was good. It was good, and God saw that it was good, including His creation of humanity in Adam and Eve. It was good. But because of sin, all people are sinners. All people are bad. And God, He didn't make some good and some bad. He made all of humanity good at the beginning. Sin has made us all bad. We are all sinful, and God chooses to save some and, according to this passage, harden others. But that was not the original state of God's creation. And the sub-point underneath that would simply be this: God's choice to save anybody at all is pure mercy. To save anybody. Because all could be condemned. So that's one thing that's going on there. The second thing would be this. We need to notice that God's purposes for His sovereign choices is to display His power and to display His mercy. So that's verses 22 and 23. So he talks about this. What if God, desiring to show His wrath and to make known His power, has endured with much patience vessels of wrath prepared for destruction, in order to also make known the riches of His glory for vessels of mercy, which He has prepared beforehand for glory. So God's patience and His purposes for His various sovereign choices is to display His power and to display His mercy. Here's the best illustration of this, and it really comes from verse number 17. Romans chapter 9, verse number 17, the Scripture says to Pharaoh, "For this very purpose I have raised you up." So if you think back to the Exodus, right? God hardened Pharaoh's heart. Remember that? God hardened Pharaoh's heart. So after the first plague, He said, "I'll let your people go," but He didn't let them go, right? Second plague, "I'll let your people go," but He didn't let them go. Third plague, all the way through 10 plagues. Now, could God have fast-forwarded through the first 9 plagues and just gone right to the Passover? Absolutely He could. But God tells us in the book of Exodus that He patiently went from plague number 1 all the way to plague number 9 and then to the Passover with all the frogs and the hail and the river Nile turning to blood and all of those things. He did it to show two things. To show His power. His power over Pharaoh and all of Pharaoh's puny armies. Right? To show His power over them, and that spread, right, that message spread throughout the known world at the time, to show His power and also to display His mercy, because on the hearts of the Israelite people, there was a holy, wow, God really does care about us and the pain of our slavery, and He is setting us free, and He's going to an awful lot of trouble to do it. And so it was to display God's power, and it was to display His mercy on His people who He was rescuing from the misery of slavery. So bottom line, anything and everything that God does is ultimately to honor and to glorify Himself. God does what God does for the purpose of His glory. And consequently, to argue with God about it is to defy His glory. Listen to this. Sometimes I quote people because I'm almost afraid to say these things myself. Christopher Ashe, commentator on the book of Romans, he's a professor in England who's taught Romans again and again and again, and I found his commentary very helpful. This is what he says. To challenge God's right to run the world is to bid for the throne of the universe ourselves. Now, so far, our passage this morning has impressed upon us that God is more powerful than we might think, that God is more sovereign even over the details, not only of the human history, not only over the universe, but over our lives and even our hearts as well. But also, the glorious flip side of this kind of hard teaching on sovereignty is that God is also more gracious than we might otherwise have expected. So number three, the surprising plans of God's grace. The surprising plans of God's grace. The subpoint under that would be this: the grace of God is exalted by expanding to unlikely people. The grace of God is exalted by expanding to unlikely people. So remember, the grace of God is exalted by humbling us. The grace of God is exalted by elevating God's glory. And number three, go ahead and give me that slide, please. The surprising plans of God's grace. The grace of God is exalted by expanding to unlikely people. So here we see this in verses 24 through 26. So he's talking about the vessels of mercy from verse number 23, and then he defines who they are. Even us, whom he has called, not from the Jews only, but also from the Gentiles. People that you would not have otherwise expected to be a part of the kingdom of God. Verse number 25 and verse number 26 are quotations from the Old Testament. Indeed, he says in Hosea, those who were not my people, I will call my people. And her who was not beloved, I will call beloved. And verse number 26, and in this very place where it was said to them, you are not my people, there they will be called sons of the living God. So the surprising plans of God's grace are ultimately, technically, the expansive plans of God's grace. In the Old Testament, there was this constant emphasis on Israelites, the children of Abraham. They were called repeatedly, right? The chosen people. This chapter is about God's choice. It is about God's election. The Old Testament, chosen people of God, they were the Israelites. You couldn't go into the temple precinct if you were a Gentile. But again and again and again, we see that in the New Testament, Gentiles seem to be coming to the faith. So in the Old Testament, there's this emphasis on the Israelite nation being the chosen people of God. Now we have in chapter 9 this emphasis on God's sovereign election, and with it this reality that we noticed in the first five verses that so few Jewish people are coming to faith in Christ, believing in Him. And then we also realize that Gentile people were all along in the fine print of God's plan from the beginning. There's even passages that if you look at them again from the Old Testament, it does seem to include the Gentiles after all. Those who were not my people, I will call my people. Those who were not beloved, I will call my beloved. We would not have expected this to be true from the overall story, especially from the Jewish mindset in the Old Testament. And yet all of a sudden, even in the New Testament period, Gentiles are believing in Christ in droves. Listen to me. The point is, here in chapter 9, somehow, beyond our ability to understand, God's gracious choices, His sovereign election, is not a limitation on the numbers of those who will be saved. It is an expansion of those who will be saved. Because we have to remember that apart from God's sovereign work in our hearts, nobody would be saved at all. And beyond that, God's gracious story of salvation from the very beginning has been and will become more expansive than we ourselves could even imagine. When we get to the book of Revelation, it's people from every tribe and every language and every nation and every people. So the surprising plans of God's grace are simply that God is more glorified by expanding salvation to unlikely people. And folks, that's us, right? That's us. We're ethnically Gentile, but religiously unqualified anyway, right? Now, there's one more thing in this passage this morning that we need to deal with. And to be honest, it's kind of an introduction to something else that's going to be coming again in chapters 10 and 11. But I do want to cover it just briefly this morning. So number four, is God just working with the leftovers, right? So we're looking at this kind of from an Old Testament perspective, and we're seeing that, you know, there's very few Jewish people coming to faith in Christ, and then a whole bunch of ragtag Gentiles. Is God just kind of dealing with the second string here on his team? And no, that's not what's going on. Let's take a look at verses 27 to 29, and see if we can see what's going on here. Verse number 27, another Old Testament quotation, Isaiah cries out concerning Israel, though the number of the sons of Israel be as the sand of the sea, only a remnant of them will be saved, for the Lord will carry out his sentence upon the earth fully and without delay. Verse number 29, and as Isaiah predicted, if the Lord of hosts had not left us offspring, we would have been like Sodom and become like Gomorrah. So essentially, technically, in the book of Isaiah, what's being talked about here is if God had not intervened, the nation of Israel would have been completely destroyed, completely eradicated during the Babylonian captivity or the Assyrian captivity, depending on the context. And yet God allows a remnant to survive, a small group to survive. Again, Paul the Apostle is picking up on this theme that so few Jewish people are coming to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. The majority of them have rejected Jesus as their Messiah. And he sees this, Paul the Apostle sees this as a continuation of the Old Testament theme of remnant theology, we might call it. In fact, he sees this situation as a direct fulfillment of Isaiah's prophecy about a remnant. Now there's, as I've already said, this is going to come up again in the next couple of chapters, and there's more than we can cover here, but there's just a couple of things that we need to kind of get in our heads today. And that is simply this. God very often starts with a small group and then expands to great things. He often starts his great plans with something that appears humanly very small and insignificant. And so we should not be surprised. Paul was not surprised that so few Jews were believing at that time. And then also the thing that we should remember is that by the time we get to chapters 10 and 11, I should say, we're going to find out that this small remnant of Jewish people is not the end of the story of what God has planned, even for the Jewish people who have rejected Jesus so wholesale. God's got something going for them as well. So no, God is not working with just the leftovers. It's not just the second string team. God is doing what God is doing, and he's doing it wisely and graciously and gloriously. At the same time, there is something of a warning here, is there not? God will carry out his sentence upon the earth fully and without delay. If the Lord of hosts had not left us an offspring, we would have been like Sodom and become like Gomorrah. In other words, there would have been a complete annihilation of the people of Israel. So we ourselves need to remember this big idea that there is a difference between being affiliated with God's people and being one of God's children. That some kind of connection to the church does not equal a standing with God. It does not equal a relationship with him. We need to examine the true condition of our own hearts. So there is a warning to the church here as well, that as church kind of people, we need to remember that being in the church is not the same thing as being redeemed and being saved and having a relationship with God. Now, how should we respond to these things? How should God's people having kind of let go of the wheel and gone down the hill with the Bible verses that are in this chapter. How should we think about this? How should we respond to these things? Well, let me respond personally first, and then let me guide us as a group through some response. Number one, I want to acknowledge this is a tough passage. This passage will make us question how we understand our own lives. This will make us question, it'll make us say things, well, like, does any of my decisions matter anyway then? Right? If everything is predestined by God beforehand, it will make us question many things. I acknowledge that this is a tough passage. And by the way, Paul did too, right? He puts some things in this passage that acknowledge that people are going to struggle with this passage. Let me say now to all of us that there are a couple of reasons why this passage is tough. Or maybe I should say it this way. There are a couple of possible reasons why this is hard for us to swallow. First of all, it would simply be human pride, right? We like to think that we are the master of our own fate, and telling us that God rules, period. God rules even the recesses of our own hearts. That is offensive to our own pride. Just, it is. Humanly speaking, that is hard to swallow. So one of our responses should be a response of humility. We should not try to soften the blow to our own pride too quickly by resolving this tension between our own sense of making decisions in any given day or week or in the early part or the late part of our life and God's sovereign rule. We should humble ourselves before this reality of God and His sovereignty. But second, and here again I want to acknowledge the toughness of this, Paul does seem to be teaching, and I should say the Bible seems to be teaching, God seems to be teaching two things that are incompatible. He has been talking about salvation by faith. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. He has been talking about these kinds of things repeatedly in Romans. And then again in chapter 10, verse number 10, he says, "For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved." He's calling for action on the part of humanity to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And then at the same time in chapter 9, he just basically said, God does it, period. God saves people. He chooses them from the very beginning. And so he seems to be teaching two things that are incompatible. And he ultimately never resolves it. He never does. How can we deal with this? Bottom line, I believe that we need to be willing to believe what the Bible says in chapter 9 and in chapter 10. Let the chips fall where they may and not too quickly try to reconcile them. Bear with me with this next illustration. This morning in my news feed, I read about a bicycle with square wheels. Doesn't seem to work, does it? No one would think that you can steer a bicycle with square wheels and you can't go anywhere. But it turns out that an engineer had taken tire material and made it into like the tracks of a army tank, and he hooked it up to the chains, and he could go pretty good with square wheels on his bicycle. Now, that's a very trite example compared to the sovereignty of God, is it not? But if God wants to make square wheels roll, He can. Period. And we need to kind of be willing to let God put whatever kind of wheels He wants to on His bicycle. Now, a couple of more applications and we'll be done. For some of us, this is a pretty familiar theme. I'll go ahead and say the C word. I've been a Calvinist since my early 20s, okay? I'll just say it. It's pretty familiar to me. I'm accustomed to these strong teachings on election. Some of you, this is like, yeah, Pastor, give me some more of that red meat, spiritually speaking, from Romans chapter 9. After this, let's do Ephesians chapter 1, why don't we? You know, let's just pour it on, Pastor. And if that's me, and it sometimes is, and if that's you, we need to remember verse number 2, where Paul the Apostle says his great grief and anguish over the lostness of humanity. He cares about people. That is why he plants churches. That is why he preaches the gospel. We need to remember the great heartbreak of the apostle over the lostness of humanity. Some of us, however, this is a bit new. There may be some sense of feeling a little bit affronted or uncomfortable or squeamish about how chapter 9 and chapter 10 fit together. How can God be sovereign and still hold us accountable to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ? And perhaps, having preached to myself for a moment, perhaps I need to say to anyone like that, that we need to simply bow the knee before the Lord and His Word and say, Lord, if this is in Your Word and if that's what it really means, I will submit to that even if I can't fully understand it or reconcile it in my own limited understanding. We also should respond with gratitude. We should simply be grateful that we heard the gospel, that our heart was softened, and we can receive the salvation offered to us at the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. No matter how you interpret Romans chapter 9, we all know that ultimately God is responsible for our salvation. We didn't send Jesus to die for our sins. God did. We did not soften our own hearts. God did. And yet at the same time, Paul the Apostle says, believe and be saved. And so I would say one of our responses should simply be, give your heart to Christ. Say, oh God, I need you and I need your forgiveness and your mercy so desperately. So gratitude and also belief and faith. Another response to these truths should be one of hope. The reality that God often does great things in hidden and small ways. God's grace is surprisingly expansive beyond our human expectations. And that should give us great hope about people that we know and love who do not yet believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Pray to a sovereign God as if He is in control and as if He can break through the hardest of hearts. And then we should worship. We should worship a God whose grace is greater than we would have otherwise imagined. His grace is greater than we deserve. It is deeper than we deserve. It is wider than we would have thought. We should worship Him. So let's bow and pray together. Oh, dear Heavenly Father, we thank You that there are some deep waters in the Bible that we frankly can honestly say are beyond us. We struggle in our limited understanding, but we bow our heads and we bow our knees before these truths. And they ultimately bring us not just to some point of mystery, but they bring us to the throne of a great and gracious God. And we worship You, Lord. We give You thanks for our own salvation. We have hope for the salvation of people that we wouldn't expect could come to faith in Christ. We have hope for the hardest of hearts. If the man Paul the Apostle, who wrote these words down under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, having persecuted the church, if his heart can be softened, any heart can be softened. And so, Lord, we cry out to You that You would work in hearts, even our own. And, Lord, we worship You for the greatness of Your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you would please stand with me and with the worship team, and we're going to close by singing Wonderful, Merciful Savior as we worship the Lord together.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and Friend, heart's always hunger for. Oh, our heart's always hunger for. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace. Hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Almighty, infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. You are the one that we praise. You are always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
Well, may our hearts hunger for him all through this week. You know, if there's anything on your heart or mind that you would like to talk or pray with me about, I certainly want to be available. I want to also say I know that this has been some rough terrain in these chapters. If you want to talk to me about some of the issues that come to your heart and mind about that, I'm always available as well. And then, may the Lord give to us the love of the Father, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Spirit to us all. Amen. You are dismissed.